So welcome to another installment of Future of Blockchain. I'm here with Corbin Pon, founder of Thesis, and a bunch of other activities in the blockchain.
Hi, thank you, Richard.
Yeah, thanks for being here. So maybe a place to start would be, tell me a little bit, Corbin, about how you made your way into this world of crypto.
So I've been an entrepreneur, graduated from Georgia Tech a long time ago, unfortunately. just been kind of in the entrepreneurial space for a long time. I remember when the Bitcoin white paper came out. Honestly, I actually thought it was a little silly at the time. I'd been studying international economics, and I thought it was funny that engineers thought they knew anything about economics. But my co-founder, Matt Luongo, started working with Bitcoin as a payment rail at a payment system, and he put that together, this website he threw together in a weekend. It did $5,000 in business. He asked me to join him because we had previously been business partners, and I kind of jumped back into the space, read through the white paper again, read through the community where it was. This is 2013. And it was a lot more mature.
Stupid than the first time?
Yeah, a little bit more mature, a little bit more promise than initial. And then I kind of got excited about a lot of the kind of democratization of payments, a lot of the ability to move around value, a lot of this idea of decoupling or disintermediating how to value things or compute things outside of the normal institutions that currently existed. Not so much I am not as big of a anarchist or libertarian as other people, but there are definitely roadblocks. There are definitely barriers to entry that could be fixed. And this was a fascinating technology. It's like blockchain and CRISPR, I think, are the biggest innovation in the last 10 years.
That's huge.
Yeah. So I was really excited to jump in at that point.
I'm waiting for quantum.
Yes, that too.
Slowly.
That too.
Yeah. Tell me a little bit about the project you're working on. Thesis, as well as the sub entities you guys are building out. You're very active. You're doing a lot. Tell me a bit about what those initiatives are, what you're hoping to achieve with them.
Sure. So Thesis is sort of our parent company. We call ourselves a blockchain venture studio with a focus on individual empowerment. So our first product that Matt and I started 5 years ago is called Fold. It's a payment app for Bitcoin and retail stores. It allows anyone to kind of just go to Starbucks and use their phone and do mobile payments with Bitcoin. And our real thesis, for lack of a better term, around that was cryptocurrency allows for these really exciting mobile payment solutions, these really kind of decentralized ownership of value and assets. And we can sort of tie that into the main payment rail system. That's a really exciting first step for adoption.
Yeah.
Eventually, we want to move it out towards more of what other kind of ephemeral payments things we do, like the way Amazon does their store, and you just kind of walk in the store and pick things off the shelves, and gets deducted from your account. For us, that kind of seamless, frictionless payment stuff is what we really want to see, and that's kind of Fold is for us a first step into that world. And our other big project is Keep Network, and Keep Network is more protocol and infrastructure level. It's a privacy protocol for public blockchains, so it allows for off-chain data computation and data storage in a private setting. So you could say store sensitive information through a blockchain, like say electronic medical records or personal voting.
Smart contracts.
Or personal voting information. Stuff that is very nice to say be verified that it exists and that it is not say manipulated or owned by someone else. But you don't actually want the details of that release, because for instance, if it's voting records in an unstable country, that could be very dangerous for someone's personal safety.
Yeah, absolutely. Cool. And tell me a little bit about, what does the world look like if you solve those two problems?
That's a very interesting question. I would love to see, for the payments thing, I would love to see just sort of value that one owns kind of seamlessly transacted without, say, waiting on settlement or say having to go to a third party market and waiting for that price to kind of be figured out. If it's very seamless, if we have ownership over our assets, our currency, should be able to pay for anything anywhere in the world really simply. For me, the dream has always been, say I want to have a beautiful beach picture on my personal website and I want someone from Madagascar, like a beach in Madagascar, and I don't want, I don't want a stock photo, I want a real one. I'm here, we're here in Boston, so I should be able to say, hey, can someone give me a picture, and I'll pay them for it, and they do, and then how do I pay them for their service? Right now, that's nearly impossible, and it is way outside the cost of what that actual asset should be. And that's kind of ridiculous.
It is, yeah, absolutely.
So that's for me a very real world example. It's a little kind of fancy, but or fantastical, but I think it's like really illustrates how seamless payments kind of opens up the market.
Yeah, no, a frictionless intent to do something without, you know, the middleman to get in the way of it.
Exactly. Yeah. And for us, a lot of it's about data privacy, data sovereignty, owning your own data. So if we want to say decouple medical records from big hospital databases and make it portable, it's nice that say as an individual I can own my medical record, I can move it around, it's accessible wherever I go, but I'm the only one who could actually unlock it and read the data.
Yeah.
And I can see if, and anyone can verify whether say data's been changed or it's been manipulated. You know, if you check the hash on the blockchain, you see something changed about it, but you can't read it, and no one should be allowed to read it without your personal permission. And for us, that's a really important way to say redefine the ownership between a data owner and the service provider.
Yeah.
So say I am running a medical test to see whether I have a potential heart condition. Yeah. It is a weird balance where the person who owns that data and is running the test is the same company. It makes more sense if they're, I have a service, I have an algorithm, and I want, and I'm gonna pay them to run the algorithm, but I only allow them to have access to the data.
At provide that use to my data as opposed to hold my data.
Exactly, and that weird mix of responsibility that currently exists, I think has messed up incentives.
Yeah.
And if we kind of split that apart, and we have strictly a service provider and strictly a data source, that makes a much more revolutionary kind of client-customer relationship.
Yeah, absolutely. So if you're ready for it, you want to jump into rapid-fire questions?
Sure, let's do it.
Okay, let's do it. Top factors hindering blockchain adoption?
Interesting. Complexity of both the technology and understanding what the concept is in the first place. I think those are really, really tough. Other big factor in the way is that unlike the internet, which kind of was just existing and was in its own little weird spot, blockchain decided to go after the finance world straight off the bat and kind of poked the tiger in the eye. And that hasn't really been helpful in terms of, say, moving fast and developing without being encumbered.
Yeah, absolutely. So regulations in the United States, are they clear or unclear for this space?
Very unclear. I don't know anyone who says they're clear. Mm-hmm. We operate within the regulations we think, because who really knows? Honestly, there's the only guidance anyone ever gets is a speech by a chairman or a memo put out by the SEC. There are no laws, there are no regulations, there's nothing to say it fits within under this code. But you know, there's no incentive for the regulators to push forward. I mean, no one's really pressuring them to actually make a decision, so they don't really have to.
Yeah, good. So tell me a little bit about how you think of the world of scalability in blockchains. So, you know, do you think scalability is a solved problem or a solvable problem in the next year?
In the next year. So our work is actually outside of the scalability field, so we don't have like strong opinions on it. We like to see it solved, obviously. But for me, I guess the real question that goes unaddressed is, what are the trade-offs between, say, security, privacy, and performance? And everyone seems to kind of not address that there's a trade-off there. Some people are very dogmatic about privacy and security are the most important things, and we should build a secure box that can never be broken, which is fine and admirable, but many use cases don't require that kind of intense security. So what is the different levels of that? And if, say, a use case requires a little less security and can improve performance by 100x, 1,000x, is that a proper trade-off to be made? I don't know. Those questions, for me, don't seem to ever be addressed by the community.
Why start with privacy?
That's a good question. I mean, besides we just believe in it as a core human value, and we found both a spot in the market that was sort of not addressed as well. It's really fun and interesting. We get to work on some really cool applied math, applied cryptography. We hopefully will empower folks to take control over their own data and their own information, I did a lot of research when I was in school in Western Africa and developing countries. There's a lot of instability there, and there's a lot of uncertainty over ownership, uncertainty of citizenship. If there's a fire and or a flood in a municipal office, your ownership of your property, your citizenship records, all of it could go away. That can change someone's life permanently forever.
Yeah.
So we believe that if we can enable this technology at scale, cheaply, that sort of changes the game for everyone in the world.
Yeah. So there's a lot of participants in the network, yep. And you've been building, your own network. Mm-hmm. Tell me a little bit about how you manage and build that, and kind of where you're trying to reinforce at the moment.
In what sense do you mean, like our personal group, or how we interact?
Keep network.
I guess, do you mean like the people working on it, or do you mean?
If it's miners or developers or.
Yeah, I mean, for us right now, it's mostly internal development. We've got a very strong kind of applied cryptography team. It's a lot of just, can we take what the research says should work and actually make it an actionable, product? And that's really important for us. So we have some sort of outside interaction with folks that we trust, both mechanic designers, cryptographers, and whatnot. But for us, it's a lot of just internal development. We keep our heads down, trying not to scare up too much attention, because we don't want to underdeliver what we're promising, because I think it's really important.
Yeah. Great. So final question. What's a project that is not one you're working on that you respect and admire?
That's a good question. You mean in the blockchain space, I'm assuming?
Yeah, or even more broadly.
I've always appreciated what Coin Center has done. Hmm. I really appreciate the work they put in. It's one of those sort of thankless jobs, being sort of a lobbyist, kind of someone interacting with government officials and regulators. And I don't always agree with what Coin Center's positions are or how they go about it, but building those allies outside of just the pure engineering world or even pure finance world, I think is very important. Eventually this tech is going to touch every part of everyone's lives, whether they know it or not, and we need to get everyone on board.
Absolutely. Corbin, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you, Richard.